I am very excited to welcome you to this event on the General Data Protection Regulation, which is going to hit all of our lives pretty hard. And as lawyers, we definitely want to start thinking about it now. Before I was here, I was an associate general counsel at Google. I was there for about 10 years. And so I feel like I saw a little bit of the data protection revolution, you know, data protection really expanding to affect more and more things. And a lot of that expansion touched on issues that are really important to our mission here at CIS. They touched on what technical innovation can look like on the internet. They touched on what free expression can look like on the internet, which is not an outcome that every data protection lawyer would have predicted in 2004. The GDPR, as our speakers today will tell you, really expands the reach of data protection in those and every other direction. So for those thinking about innovation and what technology is possible on the internet, the GDPR, like the Data Protection Directive, tells you what data you can log, how you can use that data, how long you can store it, what your UI has to look like. It puts very meaningful constraints and directions on place for the products that your clients are probably building. Hopefully those are constraints that are positive constraints. The intent is to help build products that are more protective of user privacy and to cause companies to sort of rise to the occasion and do a better job of that. But however you see it, however it comes out, this is an innovation-shaping law. It is also, in ways that came as something of a surprise a couple of years ago, a free expression-shaping law. We all knew that data protection law governed the back-end use of data that companies collected from users, you know, the records of doctors about patients, the records of Facebook about the activities of users on the site. Then in 2014, the European Court of Human Rights told us, actually, those rules also apply to content posted online by internet users. And this shift in the law, with the Google Spain right to be forgotten decision, moved data protection into being a very important factor in the information that you can find on the internet if you are in Europe. The GDPR also expands that reach. It introduces some very interesting and troubling new rules about how controllers, and probably controllers other than Google and search engines, have to honor right to be forgotten requests to delete content. It seems to me that this expansion of the significance of data protection is not unlike a moment that, if you're old enough, you probably remember from the 90s for copyright lawyers when they looked at the internet and were suddenly like, oh wait, it's all copies. Like, our copyright law affects all of this. What are we going to do? You know, if you are a data protection lawyer looking at the internet now, you've perhaps already had the experience of realizing, oh, wait a minute, this is all data. Most of it is personal data. We're going to have to figure out how to square it with this law. So I think we have some of the best possible speakers here to help out on this today. Some of them are people I've worked with in the past and who have given extremely sound and prescient advice on the new General Data Protection Regulation. I can't think of better people to address you on this. But I'm not actually going to introduce them. I'm going to hand you off to Al Gidari, who is the new Director for Consumer Privacy here at CIS, to tell you a little bit about our speakers today.
Thanks, Daphne. I don't know, add any substance to this debate at all today. I'm just here to do introductions. And it's actually a real pleasure. Dr. Mark Watts from Bristows. Mark and I go back a long way, having been involved in a couple of really interesting privacy matters for companies like Google and others. And there are very few people, in my experience as a former partner of Perkins Coie, that you can rely on with unequivocal confidence in the advice you're getting. And so with my time with Mark, it's been a real pleasure to do that. And he has a British accent, and so you know that everything he says must be true. And as every trial lawyer knows, if you need an expert witness, you pick somebody with a British accent because it convinces everybody, and I'm sure you're going to hear that today. John Bowman, who's a senior principal at Promontory, was the UK's lead negotiator in the GDPR. So we're going to learn a lot of confidential information that he wouldn't share with anybody else other than this room. And so no attribution, please, as he discloses all of those secrets. You'll notice that he also has a British accent. And so therefore, everything he tells you will be absolutely true as well. And then Michael Spadea, who's also with Promontory, is a director here in San Francisco. And he is the only one here without a British accent, and therefore you should believe hardly anything he tells you as part of his presentation. So without further ado, please welcome our guests. And I will say this in closing. To keep you in your seats, if what they tell you isn't exciting enough, there is beverages, alcoholic, and otherwise, afterwards in the lounge outside, and you'll see signs that direct you there. So that will keep you glued to your seats. You're going to go first?
I'm going to go
okay,
first.
Okay, there Thank we you. Go. Now, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. As Al said, I'm John Bowman, currently with a consulting firm called Promontory Financial Group. Previously, I was at the UK Ministry of Justice, where I spent 25 years there doing all sorts of policy work, including leading the UK delegation on international on the Hague Conventions on international child abduction. I set up a family drug and alcohol court, and I was also the UK's policy lead on Sharia law in relation to divorce and matrimonial proceedings. So, but none of that really could compare to what data protection was. I was appointed head of EU and international data protection policy back in 2011, and I had absolutely no idea what the next few years would have in store for me. But so, but what I'll do is I'll try and touch on what happened during the negotiations. It was an absolutely fascinating story, but also I'll do a run through the GDPR as well for those of you who hopefully you're all interested in this, you know, what is a groundbreaking piece of legislation and a really important one as well, not just for the EU, but worldwide. One of the reasons why we came here to California is a lot of businesses process the data of EU residents, and they will need to have an interest in what this regulation means to them. Firstly, I'd like to just thank Al and Daphne for the introduction, and also to the Center for Internet and Society for hosting us, and also Elaine for the organization as well, which is absolutely fantastic, and it's a real pleasure to be here at Stanford Law School. Okay, so just a quick introduction to the GDPR. The GDPR is definitely a game changer. I mean, in terms of EU negotiations, it was probably one of the biggest of all time. It took 4 years to negotiate, hundreds of hours of working group meetings, parliamentary discussions, and so on. If you look at the text, it runs to over 50,000 words and 200 pages. So a lot of text and a lot of rules to digest there. Arguably, it was the most lobbied piece of EU legislation of all time. The negotiations themselves are subject to a format called the co-decision procedure, and so the European Parliament, as well as the member states, have a say in what those rules are. And during the parliamentary deliberations, 4,000 MEP amendments were actually filed, which is a record for any EU dossier. So the significance of this piece of legislation really shouldn't be underestimated. And one of the things was, during the course of negotiations, a lot of people thought it would never happen. They thought it was just too big a task to introduce this whole new framework on European data protection, but it did. There was many sort of interesting incidents along the way. The Snowden revelations, also off the back of that, we had interesting landmark decisions as well in the courts, the Google Spain and the Max Schrems safe harbor decisions as well. So it's the sort of climate and the environment for these negotiations were particularly challenging in terms of the politics, but also very exciting and very interesting. And what we have here on the front slide is a picture of some of the key figures there. On the right is Vera Jourova, who's the Commissioner for Justice in Brussels, so European Commission. And second from the left is Jan-Philipp Albrecht, who is the rapporteur on this file for the European Parliament. So he's a German member of the European Parliament from the Green Party and was very influential. Some of the other people there represented the member states. So all 28 of the EU member states were heavily involved in this negotiation as well. So just to move on, I'm going to do an overview of what the regulation is and how it came into being. The regulation is the first overhaul of EU rules for 20 years. Back in 1995, there was the Data Protection Directive, called 9546 EC, a very catchy name, I'm sure you'd agree. And really, after 20 years, that piece of legislation was looking a bit tired and jaded, and really it didn't match up to the developments of the digital economy. So I think it was very much of the era of people putting the data tapes into the post, and you know they were shipped over and you might get them 5 days later, and then it would take a few hours to run in order to get the data. But very much from that era. Of course, we all know that technology and data processing has changed enormously since then. So the directive itself was being a directive as a legislative instrument means that it was actually implemented separately into all the EU member states via domestic law. So it kind of provided a minimum standard, a sort of which member states could actually apply. And then over the years, it could be seen that there was some divergence between the standards of law in the different member states. Now, when GDPR was actually proposed, this was as a regulation which is directly applicable. So the advantage for data controllers and processors would be that it would be one law for all. So if you're a big company working in multiple jurisdictions, then you'd only have to deal with this one set of rules, which made things a lot easier, or in theory should make things a lot easier. Just the last point there is that I just wanted to mention that the GDPR hasn't been formally finalized yet, but I'll come back to the timeline for that, so we'll get an idea of what the actual state of play is and where we're going with that. Just wanted to focus on some of the key elements of the General Data Protection Regulation and what it means for any organization that processes the data of EU residents. So probably one of the most interesting things is that the scope of this regulation is goes beyond the boundaries of the European Union itself. Effectively, it will apply to data controllers and processors in certain situations that process the personal data of EU residents. And this is in the context of offering goods or services to these EU residents or in monitoring their behavior when they're in the EU. So, and this is regardless of the location of the organization that is processing that data. So there could be a company here in California and they are processing EU residents' data for whatever reason. They might be a hotel or something of that nature. So therefore, they will get that data. Potentially, these rules could apply to them. So therefore, businesses who are not sure whether those rules apply to them will probably need to look at the rules and, you know, maybe even potentially get some advice on the applicability of this particular law. The scope is quite broad in that sense, and it expands on what the directive actually originally set out in the first place. On looking now at the grounds for processing, the regulation does provide several grounds for processing, some of which are already familiar and exist in implementations of the directive. During the course of negotiations, some of these positions changed quite significantly. So when the European Commission first proposed a standard of consent, that standard was set at explicit consent. So that's quite a high standard. It really has to show some sort of affirmative and positive indication that that person has understood what they're signing up to and that they've signed up to consent. What actually happened during the course of negotiations was that the wording was slightly modified. The unambiguous consent which exists in the current directive was readopted for general processing. But explicit consent was reserved for special categories of data. So special categories of data are what's known currently known as sensitive data, but it includes things like health data and things around ethnic data as well, and even probably more European concepts like trade union membership, which can actually be sensitive in certain political environments. So consent is one of the things which was really focused on during the course of the negotiations. One of the outcomes during the very last day of the negotiations was that the standard of consent, which was required for children, where children's data are being processed, there was a rule in the original draft of the regulation which said that if the child was age 13 then or below, then the consent of the parent or the responsible guardian would be required. There was some deliberation on this right at the end when suddenly a leaked draft of the negotiating text was released, and that put this age at 16. So the rather messy compromise at the end of the day was that some member states wanted 16, some wanted 13, some wanted ages in between. The decision was made to leave this down to member state law to decide whether it would be 13 or 16 or any age in between then. So one of the key benefits of the regulation was already lost during the sort of horse trading during the last days of negotiations. And it was actually very dramatic at the time. There was a concerted campaign from many different groups to try and explain that 16 is way too high an age. Children are pretty much developing their independence and so on during this particular period in their life. And 13, a lot of research has shown that 13 was the age which is a much more sort of suitable and appropriate age. But some member states decided that 16 was where it should be. So we ended up with this kind of fudge, which often happens in EU politics, as anyone who follows what goes on in Brussels. There are various other grounds for processing as well. Legitimate interest is the legitimate interest of the data controller and the business effect is one which is often relied upon. It is in my interest to do this data processing because that's the nature of my business. This was often challenged, particularly by the European Parliament, because they felt it provided a bit of a free-for-all or a get-out clause from having to use things like consent. But actually, legitimate interest was retained in the end, and it was subject to the condition that it is lawful unless overridden by the interests or fundamental rights and freedoms of the data subject. So one of the things which you'll often see throughout the text is this reference to the fundamental rights and freedoms of the data subjects, because the regulation is framed is that it refers directly to the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights. So anyone who's been following the jurisprudence in the Court of Justice of the European Union over the last few years will often see this reference to the fundamental right to the protection of personal data. So again, that's quite a European concept, and it was really crystallized in the European treaties which were negotiated in 2008 in Lisbon, which effectively set out those rights, and this is what's often referred back to. So anyone who's processing this data will often have to think about, well, is that processing actually contradicting those particular rights? But legitimate interest still exists as a ground for processing. There are other grounds as well. Public interests or vital interests of data subjects or other people, and then you can actually process for the performance of a contract or where the controller is subject to a legal obligation as well. But we often find that generally the whole debate around lawfulness of processing focuses on consent and legitimate interest probably more than anything else. There was some controversy around amendments which were made during the negotiations around further processing not based on consent. The member states wanted to preserve some element of that, or some member states did at least, but in the end it was only available to controllers to safeguard things like national security or general public interest. So the idea that once you got the consent, you can start reprocessing the data as much as possible pretty much disappeared in the final draft. Really, you might have to reobtain the consent, and you can just rely on a separate legitimate interest even after the original consent had been agreed for purposes which were different or for purposes which were not intended in the first place. So I mentioned rights before, so fundamental rights, freedoms, and interests of the European resident and the data subject. Well, some of these rights have been enhanced, and some of them have sort of hit the headlines over the last few years. In particular, looking at the right to erasure, which ended up in the text being framed as right to erasure, which again was a carryover from the 95 directive, but the term "the right to be forgotten" was actually included in parentheses and quotation marks, because in itself it became a sort of iconic brand of this regulation. So the idea that you could just request the deletion of your data because it wasn't necessary, or it was irrelevant, or it was outdated, or something like that, has sort of been crystallized in this version of the regulation. Of course, we've seen the Google Spain case is often referred to as the right to be forgotten case, although that was a much more sort of specific interest, in that it was a challenge over a search engine listing. And so the right, which eventually formed off the back of that particular Court of Justice of the European Union case, was around do individuals have the right to search engine results being delisted because they are no longer relevant, and the court found that that particular right overrided the right of the internet user and someone who wants to seek out that particular information. Although, of course, ironically, the information is still available, just the indexing and the searching is no longer available where people have exercised that right. I did just on the first paragraph there, subject access rights. For a lot of businesses, this is now a free, they'll have to be able to sort of fulfill this right free of charge. So in the UK at the moment, they can charge a £10 fee, which might have some sort of deterrent effect on mass campaigns and so on, but if there is frivolous requests, but if there is a free right, then that could certainly increase the volumes and potentially the costs on business who have to who have to provide for this right. One of the other interesting aspects is the right to data portability, and now this is actually something which is new in the regulation. Data subjects have the right to obtain their data in a structured, commonly used, and machine-readable format. What that format is, no one knows yet. It will probably be decided either by regulators, or it may well be decided by organizations such as the European Commission, who could be empowered to lay down rules on these. So, again, this could have some interesting implications for businesses in particular, but also for the data subject who may well want to extract their data and actually ask the one data controller to transfer that data to another data controller. So for organizations, they might have to put in specific facilities in order to enable this particular right. The idea was that it was a sort of consumer rights sort of enhancement, in that potentially if I was able to extract my data from one service provider, then I could shop around and ask for a better price from others. So like on things like public utilities or banks or things like that, but it could potentially pose some interesting dilemmas for organizations which have to set up the infrastructure to be able to deal with these kind of requests. Profiling is one of the things which we often get asked about. Profiling in European terms often has some sort of sinister connotation. If you think about the history of countries, particularly those which have emerged from the former Soviet bloc, which are now EU member states, and the idea that profiling is sometimes linked with surveillance and general sort of activities of government, which can be seen to be, rather disturbing and not particularly pleasant for those involved. But profiling itself is often used for things like marketing and so on, and as well as for businesses who want to learn more about their markets and do research. But what the regulation actually applies is that the data subjects have the right not to be subject to a decision based solely on automated processing, which could include profiling, which produces legal effects regarding them or significantly affects them. So it's still quite a qualified right, this, and actually this right won't even apply where where the data subject's already given the explicit consent to the processing. There was a lot of concern around this particular article on profiling to start off with, because the European Parliament had put in amendments which said that any decision of this nature which produced a legal effect or significantly affected the individual would have to be subject to a manual review by a human being. So, as you can imagine, if there is an automated system in place which is generating thousands of results, then it would be incredibly costly and totally inefficient to put all this as a matter of course to a human review. But I think luckily for everyone, really, that particular amendment was probably considered to be a little bit extreme and was removed from the final version of the text. So we know about the enhanced rights of the individuals, but in terms of obligations, data controllers and also processors in some instances have to think about certain things. So data breach notifications, 72 hours to notify the supervisory authority of a data breach is a pretty tight timetable. There is an exemption if the breach is unlikely to result in a risk to the data subject, but maybe 72 hours isn't long enough to determine whether there is a risk to that data subject or not. So that's a pretty stringent requirement there, which businesses are going to have to put in place organizational measures to be able to deal with and really know who's responsible for responding to those particular incidents. Data protection impact assessments. The concept already exists, often called privacy impact assessments, but these are required where the processing is likely to result in a high risk to data subjects, and also they will be mandatory for in cases of profiling or where the processing of special categories of data happens as well. So it could well be the case that multiple DPIAs need to be conducted, or it might be a single one for a kind of a group of similar types of processing. But again, this could be a relatively place a relatively high burden on data controllers having to conduct all these assessments all the time. And for those which show a particular high risk, they may well be well have to consult with the data protection authorities in advance in order to sort of effectively get approval for that processing. So the whole processing operation could take some time because of the requirements to conduct these assessments. Data protection officers. This is a concept which has existed in Germany for some time, but it was introduced into the GDPR as a requirement. Effectively, a data protection officer is required where the core activities consist of regular and systematic monitoring of personal data on a large scale. So although the GDPR does have quite a few definitions in there, it doesn't actually have a definition of what regular and systematic monitoring is. So I think organizations are going to think, really, do they need to have a data protection officer in place? And maybe the advice is that they have to err towards caution on this, because non-appointment of a data protection officer, particularly if an incident happened which affects individuals, could well be held against the company which didn't appoint one, because it's considered to be one of the safeguards for ensuring that the organization is actually complying with the regulation. The status of the data protection officer is quite interesting. It isn't necessarily going to be equivalent to something like a chief privacy officer, because they will advise more at arm's length. They will have a security of tenure. So effectively, it'll be very difficult to fire a data protection officer, and that's actually sort of guaranteed in the legislation. So and also one of the more interesting developments is that they could potentially be acting as a consumer advocate, because one of the amendments to the regulation which was introduced by the European Parliament says that they have to act as a point of contact for data subjects. So, you know, they may well receive some sort of complaint or something from an individual, and then they'd have to advise the company, and this has to be a senior level of management on what they should be doing about it. So it won't be like an internal counsel or an internal audit. It will be a position which is at arm's length, even though they could be an internal employee, but the actual status of that particular individual will be much more detached from from the operation of the business. Data transfers are a very hot topic. I'll be having a quick run through the privacy shield just in a couple of minutes, but the data transfers isn't too much different from what's provided in the directive, but what it does introduce is the idea that mechanisms such as binding corporate rules can be used as a method for transfer, as well as approved codes of conduct or certification mechanisms. So there is actually a bit more flexibility in terms of data transfers. We're already aware that adequacy decisions exist, and I think there's a grand total of 11 live adequacy decisions, excluding the EU-US safe harbor, which of course was declared invalid. But if you want to transfer your data to the Faroe Islands or New Zealand, then you're okay, because those particular jurisdictions provide appropriate safeguards to protect EU data. But if you want to try Russia, China, or North Korea, then I'm afraid you've had it. You can't rely on adequacy. As far as the USA is concerned, Safe Harbor provided limited adequacy for companies that self-certified, and we'll come on, and that was declared invalid. But we'll come on to the Privacy Shield, which provides some sort of facility to be able to do that, as long as it's agreed by the negotiators. The second paragraph there, I refer to transfer requests from third country or authority. This is colloquially known as the anti-Pfizer clause. It was very much put into the regulation off the back of the Snowden revelations. And the idea is that effectively there is a prohibition on the transfer of personal data unless it is based on an international agreement or an EML Act, for example. And so if there's a request from a third country authority saying that we need this particular data, for example, or for national security reasons, then effectively the country, there is a prohibition for the transfer of that data unless it is subject to an international agreement or other legal base for transfer. One of the interesting things about this is that this particular so-called anti-Pfizer clause is that the UK government has decided that they've opted out of it, and they're able to sort of draw on rather obscure EU treaty protocols, which and a rather, what I might say, is a liberal interpretation of those protocols in order to determine that this rule doesn't apply to them. So this is the first example, I think, which we can point to, that this regulation, which is supposed to be harmonizing, has already started to fragment at the member state level. There are other derogations which can apply on transfers as well, contract, public interest, and even consent, of course, and even a limited legitimate interest ground, but these would be more on an exception basis than as a general rule. Okay, so one-stop shop, new regulatory approach. So there was a fantastic idea that data controllers would only deal with, if they had multiple establishments in EU member states, would only deal with one data protection authority. So this was the so-called one-stop shop, but it actually ended up being much more complicated than that, because the member states who are negotiating this at the time decided that they cannot leave all the decisions to one data protection authority in one EU member state. So effectively, there's lots of opportunities for other data protection authorities to intervene in cases which are of a sort of cross-border interest in the EU. So what was supposed to be a very simple system ended up being, this is our sort of diagram of what this system would end up looking like. It's in your pack. It's designed as a metro map, and you can see that there's actually lots of different routes to resolution. One of the interesting things about the way this has evolved is that the European Data Protection Board will be a body of the EU and will have the ability to make binding decisions. This will provide under the EU treaties, for a route of appeal to the Court of Justice of the European Union. So those of you who've been following all the cases in this over the last few years will know how powerful and influential the rulings of the Court of Justice of the European Union are. So that would be quite interesting in terms of the developing jurisprudence as the application of the GDPR starts to bed down over the next few years. And probably one of the biggest headlines is around administrative fines, potentially up to 20 million euros or 4% of worldwide annual turnover for certain infringements. So 4% of worldwide annual turnover is just a huge amount. So turnover is what you would refer to as revenue here, I think. And so if there's one thing which is going to get this regulation noticed at the executive levels, then it's going to be the potential size of these fines. And I sort of wonder whether there's going to be a bit of a race to the top in terms of which regulator is going to issue the first worldwide turnover fine, but I'm pretty sure that it won't be that long, but who knows? Maybe then. Part to agreement. So as I mentioned, we're not quite there yet in terms of having ratified the rules, but there will be various stages still to go, mainly a council vote in April. The council is the 28 EU member states. European Parliament vote on the text early May. Entry into force will follow publication in the official journal of the European Union, and then entry into force is 20 days after that. Then the rules will start to apply 2 years down the line. So our estimate would be June 2018. And in the meantime, though, 2 years, there's still going to be a lot of activity going on. There's going to be agreement of delegated implementing acts. So these are kind of secondary legislation. There's going to be a scramble for member states to establish their own carve-outs. We can look at Article 21 of the regulation in particular, which allows for member states to apply restrictions to the rights of individuals. So some member states might look at the right to be forgotten and say, well, we don't really like it, and we can find lots of good reasons why we shouldn't have it. So who knows what's going to happen. EDPB, the European Data Protection Board, there's going to have to be appointment of a chair, new chair. That's going to be an immensely powerful position. And people will have different views on who they think is going to be the best person to have that job. There'll be guidance by supervisory authorities, potentially more court judgments, which are going to anticipate the GDPR. And maybe one other thing, which is happening in approximately 3 months' time in June, is the UK-EU referendum. And who knows how this regulation will apply to the UK if we decide to leave the European Union. There could be all sorts of issues around applicability of law, how the one-stop shop works, and whether even we'd have to apply for an adequacy decision, which may well be refused anyway, because the UK could no longer rely on the privileges of EU membership, which give an exemption to national security issues. So a lot to ponder there. Okay. And we're going to touch very briefly on the Privacy Shield as well, because this is something which happened in the last few weeks, really. And of course, this replaced the safe harbour, which was declared invalid by the Court of Justice of the European Union in the case of Max Schrems against the Irish Data Protection Commissioner. So, Privacy Shield it doesn't introduce policies; it kind of reaffirms the privacy principles which self-certifying organisations need to apply in order to transfer personal data from the US to the EU and back and forth. And I won't go through the main principles there, but I think there are some interesting strengthening of what was there in the safe harbour, in particular around the contractual arrangements which need to be put in place for the onward transfer. So the recipient of that data, if it's another third party, has to subscribe to these strengthened principles as well. But I suppose in some ways what this is an export of EU data principles to the US. These are very much sort of horizontal principles which apply across the data processing use cases. It's not so much it's much less of a sectoral approach that you find over here, of course. And there'll be much more robust handling of and enforcement as well. So one of the things which data controls will need to put in place is effective redress of mechanisms. And one of those things will actually, they have to be able to provide recourse free of charge to data subjects. So through the provision of alternative dispute resolution mechanisms. So It'll be interesting to see how many people actually use these mechanisms. I think there's been very little uptake under the safe harbor, but maybe some groups might think, well, this is an opportunity to really challenge some of the processing which is going on in the US, and really, is it suitable? So having free access to these mechanisms might provide an interesting incentive for possibly activists who want to kind of make their mark on particular organizations. But there'll be a lot more stronger enforcement as well by the Commerce Department and the Federal Trade Commission. And I think that's important, because one of the things which Safe Harbor didn't is sort of provided for these mechanisms, but generally it wasn't robustly enforced outside of some particular specific cases. And the US will administer the the Privacy Shield. The Commerce Department will maintain things like lists of self-certified businesses, and they'll also remove organizations who aren't complying with the Privacy Shield principles from the list, and those organizations may well need to actually delete the data as well. I mean, that's what the implications will be for business, but the Privacy Shield does actually introduce some other interesting aspects which sort of develop more from the political side of this negotiation. And I think one of the interesting things about Privacy Shield was, to the extent that even after 2 years of very tough negotiations, there were, the two sides, the US Department of Commerce and the European Commission, actually managed to meet fairly well in the middle, and this is in particular around national security safeguards. So a new independent ombudsman will be provided in order to deal, in the US, will be provided to deal with examine complaints from data subjects around surveillance by national security authorities and so on. So that was a very interesting innovation. But again, with the GDPR, this still needs to go through a formal ratification, and some people have sort of challenged whether it's actually, any more than a kind of rehash of the safe harbor. Jan Philip Albrecht just called it the reheated serving of safe harbor. So he was obviously yet to be convinced by Privacy Shield. But I guess the question is if we don't have Privacy Shield, what is the alternative? Will people just carry on transferring data without any safeguards? Or because the other methods and mechanisms are expensive and complicated and might not suit everyone. So that's where we are. So without further ado, I'd like to hand over to Mark Watts to do the next session. Thank you.
Thanks, John. Can you all hear me okay? Yeah? Is that a yes?
Right. I would say it's going to take about 3 or 4 months to actually finalize it, because it needs to be approved by the 28 member states. Whether it will be, I think it will come into force, and companies will start to self-certify if they think it's the right thing for them. But what actually happened post-Safe Harbor was a lot of organizations were starting to put in place alternatives to safe harbor, things like standard contractual clauses, which provide a different mechanism for transfer. So whether there might be some hesitancy until Privacy Shield is bedded down, because people might be worried it would be subject to a similar challenge that safe harbor was. So it remains to be seen, really, but I think it is worth highlighting that it was a significant achievement to that agreement was reached in the first place. It was a very tough negotiation, and there was a lot at stake. So I think optimists would be willing to give it a chance and see what happens. But it might be that skeptics will think of some way of challenging it, possibly through the courts.
Okay.
Sure. I'm sorry, can you go to the microphone? Because we record, so there's a microphone right next to you in the aisle.
Yeah. acceptable step forward?
I'll just, I pick it up. And
if that's something you're going to cover later, Mark, yeah.
We touch on it anyway.
Okay.
Right, well, hi, everybody. So I'm Mark. I'd like to add my thanks to Al and to Daphne and to Elaine and Amanda for sorting this all out. It's fantastic. It's lovely to be here. It's quite daunting, actually, speaking to a Silicon Valley audience about technology. I feel like I'm about to describe pop music to the Beatles or something like that. But what I'm going to try and do is I'm going to take some of the concepts that John has described, and then I'm just going to say, well, okay, so here's the technology, here's how this might apply, here are the problems. Now, I'm going to pose a question, but I don't want you to answer it. I'm going to come back to it. I'm going to try and remember to come back to it at the end, which is this. Is the GDPR well-suited to technology? Hold that thought, okay? And we'll come back to it, as I say, at the end. So the reason I'm saying, I'm asking that is because, as John touched on, one of the reasons they wanted to rehash data protection law in Europe was because the old one predated the web, let alone apps and cloud and social. So the feeling was we needed something that was a little bit more tech-friendly, shall we say. So did they accomplish that? That's really my question. So what I'm going to be doing, I'm going to be looking at cloud, grown. You've all heard about cloud loads of times, but not about GDPR, maybe, in the cloud context. Big data, Internet of Things, and we'll have a few words about apps as well. I'm not going to do all of the issues for each of the technologies. I'm just going to pick out a few. Several of them will apply to all of them, but I'm going to try and keep the repetition to a minimum. Right, so this is a picture of a representation of cloud. The only reason it's there is just to remind everybody how complicated it can get. So all the different layers, so all the different service provisioning layers, infrastructure, platform, SaaS, all on top of each other. Beneath that, there'll be a technology layer, hardware, operating systems, databases, services. Amidst all that, there'll be loads of different players. There'll be contractors, subcontractors, data subjects, customers. And then there's geographic complexity. It'll be distributed all over the world. It's a complicated mess, and that's what GDPR is trying to apply to when it's addressing cloud computing. Right, so I thought what we would start with is, what does it mean for cloud providers? Well, the first thing it means is that they are going to have some direct obligations. Now, in the main, under the existing law, processors don't. So the controllers, the guys who own the data, the customer using the cloud provider, they are up to here with obligations that they have to comply with. Processors, almost nothing by law. It's all contractual. That is going to change. So for the first time, processors will have some fairly hefty compliance obligations of their own and some very hefty fines, potentially, if it all goes wrong. So what does this mean? It means that this stuff changes for cloud providers from being a sales issue to a compliance issue. So a cloud provider has got to put forward a compliance solution for data transfers, a decent contract, or whatever, or its customer won't be able to comply with its obligations and the cloud provider won't sell much stuff. So that will still apply, but now they've got their own things to worry about. They can have it enforced against them. When does European law apply? Most of the cloud providers would have some data center or presence in the US. They may have a local presence in Europe as well. But when does EU law apply? So under GDPR, the first bit stays the same as now. If you're a cloud provider providing services to Europe and you have a stable operation, let's call that an office. It doesn't have to be a company. It can be a branch. It can be anything. A place where people can go to work every day, you're done. You're established. Your operations will be subject to European law. Now, a lot of the cloud providers, of course, don't have that. They would be providing their services out of the US. Would they be subject to European law? Well, for controllers, it's a bit more straightforward. But for processors, it's actually quite difficult because the second part of the test is, even if you've got nothing in Europe, but the processing activity involves you directing goods and services at Europeans, so maybe you're taking local currency, maybe you're doing it in local, you're doing it in French, German, whatever, then that can be enough for European law to apply, okay? So there's a lot of service providers out there who will be providing services to European-based businesses who may need to think about compliance with some of this stuff and these big fines for the first time, potentially. In terms of data protection officers, John mentioned it already, If you're a cloud provider, then you probably meet the test for having to have a data protection officer. Your core activities probably do, amongst some of your customers, consist of regular and systematic monitoring of individuals in Europe. If you get over that threshold, then you would need to appoint a data protection officer. Now, I'll just flag this because you all have it. There's a handout at the back with a bunch of FAQs, the things we're getting asked all the time about appointing data protection officer. Can it be a company? Can you have one for the whole group? Do they have to be in the same time zone? So feel free to take a look at that. Now, one of the worst things about doing European data protection law if you're an advisor is every now and then a client will come to you and they'll say, we've got 20 gazillion IT systems and we need to notify them with the regulators in all 28 countries. And there's a ton of paperwork. If none of you have done it, imagine filling out a tax return for every database inside your company and then filing it in every country in Europe. That's only a slight exaggeration. So the good news is that goes. New law, gone. We don't have to do that anymore. The less good news, particularly for a cloud provider, is that that external bureaucracy is replaced with an internal bureaucracy in the form of you have to maintain a register of processing operations. So you would have to keep, as a cloud provider, you'd have to keep a record of all your customers, each one. What data do you process for them? Contact details for their data protection officer. If you're transferring data out of Europe, you would have to keep a record of some of the aspects of that. And all of that would have to be made available upon request to a data protection authority. So cloud providers who are subject to this stuff are going to have to think about this and think about changing their processes. And although we're talking about June 2018, when this comes into effect, if you're a cloud provider and you're wanting to sign a contract that would run past June 2018, this is on your desk now. So we're already in negotiations, seeing customers saying, well, that standard template is fine, but that's last year's model. We've got some new obligations under the new law. We need to have additional provisions in there. It impacts sub-processing. The whole basis, if you like, of cloud is a distributed level of processing, lots of parties involved, lots of sub-processing being done. You can now only do that with the consent of your customer as a cloud provider. And if you appoint a new subcontractor, you have to tell them. And if they don't like it, they can object. And so there's a bit of a debate at the moment. Well, what does object mean? If it means they get a right to terminate, that isn't great, but that's okay. You can live with that. If they get a right to object, then that would mean that some of your cloud operations would be able to use that subprocessor and some of it wouldn't. And that would rapidly unpick the way that cloud typically works. Breach notification, John has already mentioned. If you're a cloud provider and you have a breach, you need to tell the controller. There's no particular time period, just without undue delay, as soon as. Just your customer. And then any of you who've done cloud negotiations will know that one of the biggest punch-ups is often about physical right of inspection. So some regulated entities, they push the bank or whatever it is to get a contractual right to walk around the data center of the processor. I don't know what good that serves. I imagine it's like going to IKEA when it's closed. You just kind of you just walk around and you see stuff. There's nobody there. You feel better, maybe. I don't know. Anyway, that is in the law now. That is a right that data protection authorities will be able to inspect cloud providers, and cloud customers contractually have to get themselves the right to knock on the door and do that little IKEA trip. Now, the other thing that's interesting is that this whole thing about transfers and privacy shield and BCRs and model clauses and all this stuff, it used to be the customer's problem. If the customer had data, their data transferred out of Europe, and there weren't any of those things in place, they're in breach. Now that's an obligation on the processor as well. So the cloud provider is going to have to think about, well, I'm getting this data from these customers. On what basis are they giving it to me? Because now it's not just their breach, it's my breach as well. That'll be a significant change. Right. So what does it mean for users? At the moment, there's two mandatory clauses you've got to have in a services agreement in Europe. if you're using a cloud provider. Everybody has loads more, but there's two mandatory ones. That list is going to grow significantly. Cloud contracts are going to have to get a little bit more elaborate and go into a lot more detail about what the processing is and what's being done. And then the other thing that's going to happen is the processor, we're already seeing this as well. They are starting to push back, because it used to be that the processor would be thinking, all right, okay, if I really stuff up and the controller, my customer sues me, how liable do I feel comfortable with? And they'd be thinking about their own liability contractually to the controller. Now they're thinking, wow, what if I get that 4% of global revenue fine? How much of that do I want to swallow? How much of that do I want to push back to the customer? And you might say, well, okay, so how is it that the customer could do something wrong that results in the cloud provider getting the massive fine? Well, it's unlikely, I agree. But say it's a customer that's a bit shabby with their compliance. Already the regulators are grumpy, right? They're in a bad mood. It just raises the likelihood of there being a complaint, somebody making a complaint to a regulator, the regulator taking enforcement action. That could result in a claim for the cloud provider. More likely, and this isn't cloud, this is now regular outsourcing. We're talking about an IBM, an Accenture, somebody like that. They go into the customer. The first thing they do, they bought all of their systems, everything, as part of an outsourcing. And they use the same systems with all their flaws and weaknesses to provide the same services back to the customer for 10 years. They have inherited that compliance problem. They bought it, actually. And so to the extent those systems don't allow compliance by the provider, they're going to get fined, even though ultimately it was down to the customer. So we're going to see some really bitter negotiations at midnight on the last night before the deal signs. We see that already. I think it's just going to get a little bit harder. One of the other questions we get asked in the context of cloud is, particularly for infrastructure stuff, is, right, the data, it's encrypted. We're putting the data in the cloud. They will never, ever, ever get the encryption key. It's not personal data, is it? We get that. And we will occasionally get a regulator to nod along with that informally. They don't really like any conclusion that says something isn't personal data, because it means they lose jurisdiction. But it's still, I can think of a lot of deals where that has been at the heart of it, that construct, that as long as you keep the encryption key away from the provider, they are not handling personal data, so you don't have to worry about transfers. You haven't got to do model clauses. We see that quite a bit. Now, I think under the GDPR, the definition of personal data and the introduction of a special category of coded data, essentially, pseudonymous data, makes that argument a bit harder to run. And then, interestingly, on Privacy Shield, they've left in, sort of revamped, one of the old principles that used to be in there for pharmaceutical data that said, coded data, not personal data, if it gets transferred to the US without the code. So we have a slight, there's a little bit of a tension there. One of them is super helpful for organizations, the other considerably less so. Breach notification, I'm not going to go into. Again, John has mentioned it already. In terms of transfers, I'll just say a couple of words about this. Several data protection lawyers' phones in London melted the day of the Schrems decision. And I've not used the phrase "don't panic" so many times over the course of such a short period. Everybody wanted to know what to do. Oh my God, safe harbor's gone. What are we going to do? Well, everybody saw, not everybody, a lot of people looked at consent again and saw why a lot of people didn't use consent, because it's actually quite difficult to do. A lot of providers started using model clauses, whereas up until that point they'd really, really disliked it. And it's not a good fit, but that's what we're seeing at the moment. We're seeing model clauses being used. As Privacy Shield moves forward, assuming it comes to fruition, I expect to see that fading out. But it's kind of uncertain to the question earlier. We don't really know what level of confidence people need to get to that Privacy Shield is going to carry on existing before they're going to bother doing it, and before they're going to trust a service provider based on their Privacy Shield. There's a bunch of things, a bit of detail. I'm not going to go into it. John has mentioned it already. The contractual piece, the paperwork piece of cloud contracting, if it's a Privacy Shield situation, there's some stuff to do on that. I'm not going to go into it. But there is one thing I want to highlight. So what you're very likely to have is service provider in the US addressing EU data, okay? So they pass the jurisdiction test. They're subject to EU law. That means they've got to put in place processes, policies, procedures, all that stuff to comply with the regulation. Okay? Yes? Yeah. Now, they're going to receive data on the basis of Privacy Shield. That requires them to have a compliance program as well. That's kind of what it is. It's got to have something that respects the principles. So you've got the same organization having to put in place a compliance program to meet European law and put in place a compliance program to satisfy Shield. They're only going to have one compliance program, you would think. So there's a piece of work to be thought through about how do you take those principles, notice, choice, the very familiar US terminology of essentially safe harbor, and how do you reconcile that with some of the requirements that we're seeing under the regulation. So there's quite a bit to do there, I think. But, you know, all very doable, of course. Right. Yeah.
You touch on, you had a bullet point up there, I'm not sure if you talked about the localized infrastructure.
Yes.
So if you're a provider and you stand up infrastructure in Europe,
yep.
How does that now impact your business?
It makes some people feel quite a bit better. So if the customer is in the public sector or heavily regulated, maybe financial services industry, they get a greater level of comfort that they can tell people maybe the data isn't leaving Europe in quite the same way. That's seldom true, because although there will be a local EU instance of the data center, the support will probably be provided remotely from the US or whatever. So it's sort of better, but there will still be data transfers. You will still need model clauses probably or Shield or something else.
So it's largely perception.
Well, for the providers, without wanting to do any of them a disservice, I think it's a sales move, right? If you want to sell into Germany, kind of helps to have a German data center. It's as simple as that, and it really does. And there are lawyers in Germany who would say that is much more compliant actually than having Privacy Shield or model clauses or whatever. So there is some upside. The question for the provider is it worth it? Have I got enough customers to warrant building a whole new data center? Is that right? Okay, right. Internet of Things, let's have a look at that. Again, this is really just to underline the complexity. If you look closely, very closely, you can see, what can you see? You can see some connected cars. You can see some Fitbits. You can see some sort of smart city stuff. You could probably see domestic appliances talking to each other. This, by the way, is the bit of Internet of Things that creeps me out the most. The idea that my fridge and my scales are talking behind my back. That is that is bang out of order. Anyway, right, so you all kind of know what it is anyway, right? So I've got a thing. What's a thing? There's a lot of chat about what's a thing. This is the definition of one of the team members here, who's the professor of privacy at London University. And he says it's anything. A thing is a thing, is basically what it's saying. But it's connected, and it's smart, and it does things. So I don't need to go through all the examples. The bit I wanted to pose, though, was this. We've all had some experience of Internet of Things. There'll be loads of people in the room wearing a Fitbit, I imagine. That's the simplest example. There'll be lots of people in the room with a Nest smoke detector or a drop cam or something like that. That's fine. Lots of them, loads of examples. But in the main, they're kind of closed systems. So your Fitbit talks to your phone, and then it maybe interacts with Facebook or whatever in the back-end service. And then there's some product integration, and I get it. But in the main, it's a closed little universe. And then the same with the Nest one. You know, that talks to some of the Google stuff and whatever. The engineering view of this is that to really realize the power of Internet of Things, all of those separate, somewhat separate systems all need to start talking to each other. We need ubiquitous mass data sharing in order to realize the power of the Internet of Things. So my car needs to talk to my phone, to the traffic lights, the car overtaking me, the ambulance to pick up the car I ran into person, and everything needs to talk to everything. Why do I say that? Because then you've got to ask the question, well, what's the role of data protection in that? So if you're going to have mass sharing of all of these systems, data going everywhere, you can see how some of this stuff, all this talk of consent, legitimate interest, notice, could kill it. The wrong data protection laws could make that level of data protection data sharing very, very difficult. Equally, if you think about, so do I want my car talking to somebody else's car? Do I want it talking to the traffic lights? Do I want that data sharing? Well, I'm only going to want that data sharing if I have a sense of trust that the recipient is going to use the data the right way. What builds that trust? The recipient being bound by certain data protection rules. So data protection rules here are both, they could kill it, or they could enable it. So you sort of want the right level of data sharing, of data protection for the data sharing. And so just on this, does the GDPR do that question? Is it good for technology? That's one of the questions that I would pose in particular. Got an eye on the clock. Right, I'm just going to rattle through this fairly quickly. Is this stuff personal data? So all these sensors everywhere. Now, in the US, forgive me, I know you're a very sophisticated audience, but typically you would think in terms of PII, roughly, and you'd say, well, it's not really PII. In Europe, we talk in terms of personal data, and that's just, does it identify an individual, and is it about them? And it brings this idea of context in, and what that means in terms of Internet of Things is it's hard to find an example of something that, in a certain set of facts, wouldn't be personal data. So the sensor on the drill bit of an oil rig, it's about as industrial and far from people as you can get. Would that data be personal data? Well, if there were an accident and that data were a record of the user and what they were doing in an industrial claim or litigation in Europe, that would become personal data. So this is very, very broad. And that means the effect of the GDPR on Internet of Things is very, very significant. So I'll just highlight some big issues. Transparency. How do you give notice here? How do you give notice when your fridge is talking to your scales? How do you do that? You can't. So they're going to have to innovate on compliance. That's why we're thinking about QR codes, dashboards. You go to your app. It tells you about all the sharing and stuff that's being said about you by your appliances. What else? I'm just going to pick out some of these. The point John made about portability, this idea that as an individual, I can go to a controller and say, I would like you to take all of the data you've got about me and give it to that big competitor of yours. How does that work in terms of the Internet of Things? It sort of makes sense a little bit in the context of, say, social network, maybe. I want to switch networks, so I want all my stuff over on that one. But even then, right, that isn't all my personal data. That's a bit of my personal data, but all the stuff about my friends, everything else, that's their personal data. Do I get to move that as well? It's complicated, would be the conclusion there. If you're going to be doing something that is super techie, like Internet of Things, anything like that, it's very likely that that would tip into the requirements that John mentioned, where you have to do a privacy impact assessment. So if there is risk and it's created by technology, as a rule of thumb, you should be working through the sequence saying, all right, what are we doing? Why are we doing it? What's the risk? How do we mitigate the risks? And documenting that and building in whatever safeguards you can to minimize those risks. Okay, now big data. So I guess you all know what big data is. This move from we don't have a big data set and pick out a little sample and draw a line between the three data points and that's our conclusion. The idea that we now analyze everything. We will get a lower error bar on our conclusions if all of the data has gone into the analysis as opposed to just a little bit of it. A silly example, if you imagine a graph with two points on it, you can see how susceptible it is to the error on this point. You have 25 gazillion points in there. If a few of them are wrong, it's not going to move anything. And that's sort of what we're getting at here. That's why you can accept messy, inaccurate data. And it's all about moving from causation to correlation. I couldn't resist reading out some of my favorite correlations. It's something of a detour, I apologize. But it's not about this happened and it led to that. It's just about there's a relationship between these two. You don't need to know why. Don't worry about it. Don't waste your time thinking about it. You just need to know of the relationship. So the number of people who drowned by falling into a pool correlates with films Nicolas Cage has appeared in. Who knew? the per capita cheese consumption, you might know this one, the per capita cheese consumption correlates with the number of people who accidentally died by becoming tangled in their bed sheets. Who knew? Who? Why? I don't know. It doesn't matter. You just know. And so now you know. If any of you were thinking, right, we'll get the cheese and the Nicolas Cage movies in tonight, then don't, right? Because that could be quite dangerous. So anyway, so it's what we're talking about on a more serious note is taking every scrap of data you can find anywhere inside your organization, throwing some serious algorithms at it, and seeing what comes out. What are the challenges of that for the data protection rules in Europe? I'm not going to talk about applicable law, save to say if you're monitoring Europeans' behavior, you're done. EU law will apply. And then this question of what is personal data becomes really important, because if all that data you've got that you're throwing all these algorithms at is anonymous, don't need to worry about data protection anymore. You're fine. You can do whatever you want with it, pretty much. But under the GDPR, as I mentioned, the bar for anonymity is higher. So it is a slightly broader concept of when is something personal data. The idea of identifiability just got broader. So whereas in the, again, without wanting to pick on the US or any particular law or anything like that, this concept of PII, how you'd quite often need to have, maybe not a name, but perhaps the prospect of being able to find out who the person is in the real world and rock up in front of them and shake their hand, and then they're identified. In Europe, that is gone, I would say. All we need now is the ability to single somebody out online, to know that the person on your website on Tuesday is different to the one on Monday and not the same as the person on Wednesday, but you recognize them again on Thursday. Even though you have absolutely no idea of who they are in the real world, you see a pattern. You can single them out. That's the test. And when the definition of identifiable is so wide, you can see how hard it becomes to make data anonymous. So actually, saying you just make all the data anonymous for your big data isn't so helpful, because it's kind of hard to do. Nevertheless, so the good news coming, right? It's good news. There's this concept of pseudonymous data, which is essentially coded data. You've taken the data, you've removed the identifiers, and you've put the identifiers over here. The data is over here, and you put in place something to stop the two ever meeting again. If you do that, then with the data over here, the pseudonymized data, you can really, you know, do some stuff to it. You can apply some analytics, find some stuff out, and you're good. You're okay. That's compliant. The data's still personal data, just to be clear, but it's not directly identifiable anymore, because for that, you'd need the codes. And then the question then comes, right, well, actually, we do want to identify people. For this bit of analytics, we want them to be identified, and we want to find something out about them, and we want to do something to them. How can we do that? And then you're taking head-on this, essentially, this concept in European law, which is you collect the data for a purpose, and that purpose stays with the data cradle to grave. This is kind of how it used to be. And it determines everything. It determines who you can share with. It determines when you've got to delete the data. Everything is tied to this purpose. But the question here is with big data is, well, I collected that data for the purpose of selling a book. Now I want to use it for something completely different. I don't even know what, because my algorithms haven't told me yet, but it could be amazing. Can I do that with identifiable data? And we get a little bit of help under the regulation. I'm not going to read them all out, because I'm just going to give you an example, because it's easier. So you run through this checklist of the link between the original purpose and the second purpose. Let me give you, it's a real example in the sense that it's a case that crossed our desk. So start with a simple one. I run a website, and I'm going to describe Amazon, basically. I'm Amazon. I run a website. I sell books. And let's say I sell something. I'm going to pick on you. I sell you a book. And for whatever reason, something goes wrong. I don't get paid. You get the book. The purpose of having your data was fulfillment or something like that. You owe me money. You refuse to pay. I start chasing you for the debt. The purpose becomes legal, really. Legal purpose. Litigation. Can I do that? Of course I can do that. It just feels right, doesn't it? Of course it does. And that's because it would meet that test of the legal purpose, recovering the money for the book you got, is kind of compatible. Yeah, does that feel okay? Is that good? Everybody all right with that? Right, another example. I run a website. I sell books, but I also allow people to post comments on books as well, that are user-generated content. And there's something very defamatory on the website. And I get sued, it's all my fault, all the rest of it. And I have data about who came to the website and who saw those remarks. And in the litigation, the other side wants access to that information so they know who saw that. They want to be able to prove that 1,000 people saw those defamatory remarks on my website. Like I said, a real example, that would be the wrong side of the line. Taking the data about somebody who just was visiting a website, and then that data then suddenly popping up in litigation, goodness knows where, that doesn't affect them in any way, that they had absolutely no idea that might happen, that probably wouldn't be compatible. Do you see what I mean? So that's how one has to think about it. Okay, moving on. So that's when you want identifiable data. And then the other big out here, or helpful thing in the regulation, particularly, there's a lot in here that helps big data, actually, is there's an idea that if the processing is for statistical purposes or archive purposes or scientific research, then I'm paraphrasing horribly here, but essentially, if you do your best to make it as de-identified as you can, then even if you're not successful, you're okay. You get relieved from the obligation to give notice, the obligation to delete data, the obligation not to collect it for one purpose and use it for another. You can do all that if it's truly for scientific purposes. John has touched on the rights to object already. I can pick that up in questions if necessary, but let's get on to apps. So you all know, I'm sure, any app is always, even if it doesn't give your name away, there's a whole world, ecosystem of identifiers that's being shared between phones and servers and providers and all the rest of it. And a lot of the time, people rely on that as being anonymous. In Europe, it isn't anonymous. I would say it's not anonymous now, but under the GDPR, it certainly won't be anonymous because online identifiers are called out specifically as being personal data. So all your IDFAs and your IMEIs and all that, that'll be personal data in Europe. Quite often in apps, we will come across some sensitive personal data. And so, again, most of you will know this. In Europe, we have personal data, and then there's this little subset called sensitive personal data, which is the really juicy stuff about health and race and the really kind of religious beliefs, that kind of stuff. Extra rules apply to that subset. Well, what they've done under this is to expand it. It now includes biometric, so your thumb on your iPhone, maybe. And it also includes, I'm having a jet lag moment. sensitive data, biometric. Oh, it always included health data, but there are also special rules for health data. And what is interesting is what we see on a lot of wearable apps is data starting off as being about fitness and then tipping at some point into being about health, particularly if it gets into weight. Predictive weight gain over 6 months and, you know, all the health consequences of that. At some point, it becomes health data. It becomes sensitive personal data, and that means the compliance obligations go up. Location data isn't sensitive personal data, but there's another law that sits alongside this one that has special rules for location data, which is why there's all these prompts in the operating systems of mobiles. That at the moment, isn't changing. Right, I'm just going to pick out a couple of things on consent. Look at all the things consent has to be. Freely given, specific, informed, unambiguous indication of wishes from a clear affirmative action. It's quite a lot of stuff there. And people get a little bit mixed up about this, I think, because consent conversations often resolve into tick box conversations, and then it becomes about opt-in and opt-out. And I think if you focus on the definition when you're advising your organizations, you'll get a bit more room, I think. The key for me is it's an act, and it doesn't say what the act has to be. It can be anything. I would say on a web form, ticking the box isn't the act anyway. The act is clicking send. And so the point here is you set it up so that you tell the user what they're going to do, what is going to be consent. By clicking this button, you agree, blah, 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 and then you let them do it. And if you do that, you should be able to meet these requirements anyway. Now, there's a few things coming that are in the category of not great news, I'm afraid. Restrictions on burying. So I'm not talking about any organization's privacy policy, but we see so many where it'll be on the web form, it'll say, I agree to this privacy policy, or I agree to the processing of this privacy policy, and then in the privacy policy, in clause 500 or something, right at the back, there'll be, you consent to sensitive data being processed, transfers, whatever it is. And that's what I mean. Buried isn't meant to be pejorative. What we have to do now is, if in that document you are trying to get consent, you have to pull it out, you have to call it out, essentially. You have to flag it. So where this is heading is we're seeing essentially layered privacy notices. So the full policy is there, you can agree to it, go read it, fine. But the key points, the fact that you're processing, the data will be transferred to the US or whatever it might be, you probably don't have to worry about that one so much, but it's already here. But anyway, pulling out the consent statements, we're starting to see, and we will see more of. And then bundling, what does that mean? That means if you get somebody to agree to a privacy policy or to terms of service, and in there, boy, are you getting some consent. They're agreeing to this, they're agreeing to that. They're agreeing to a wide range of processing far beyond what is required for you to deliver the service. That's a problem. That's what we're getting in the GDPR. Okay? So where that will go, I think, is you will identify what is the service? What is it I'm providing them? What is the processing I need to do for that? That's one area of consent. Anything after that would be into optional, and maybe they get a greater level of choice for that. John has mentioned the rules for children's consent already. I quite like the next slide because this is about the notice, okay? So giving the data protection notice, the requirement that it should be concise. Even the list of things that's in it can't be concise. So we're all used to the idea that we have these long-winded privacy policies that nobody reads. I get that. But that's why these layers and just-in-time notices, and we're seeing a bit more innovation on the way notice is given, particularly in mobile, where there's a very small amount of space. I'm not going to read all of that out, because you can do that yourselves, but I'm going to pick out... Could this be a mistake, John, right? I'm going to put it to you. It reads like a list of, you've always got to do all of these things. You've got to say who you are, why you're collecting the data, all the rest of it. And then halfway down it says, plus, if necessary for fairness, you've got to do these other things as well. I added the if, okay? In the law, there's no if. It sort of only makes sense if there's an if. But it reads as, you just got to do it. You just got to crack on and say all of these things. So anyway, right, we're nearly done. I'm not going to go through all of these because I've covered most of them already. Now, every now and then, as a Brit, I will hear somebody say, technology law in the UK, okay. You know, the US is probably 18 months ahead of Europe when it comes to technology. And can I just say how wrong that is? Because if you look at these icons, which were the ones that the Parliament produced, I think you'll find you're 18 years ahead of Europe, because in Europe we still have floppy disks. Look at the second one. I love the bag of money as well. That gives you some idea of the Parliament's view of monetization of data, right? Grubby bag of money. Anyway, look, these aren't, they're not for real. Well, they are for real, but they're just not in the law. So the idea that you've got all these notices, but why don't we have alongside it a sort of milk carton idea or food labeling idea? At a glance, you can tell whether they're going to sell your data or not. Good, that's in there. The idea of icons, good, that's in there. In the Parliament draft, though, they went as far as to draw them or get them drawn, and that's what we got. And the third one down, we call that a roundabout. You'd probably call that a traffic circle. Is that what you call it? We draw like a traffic sign, yeah? Anyway. Right, nearly done. I'm not going to talk about the other stuff because I've covered it already. The right to erasure, Daphne mentioned, John has mentioned. That's quite significant in terms of apps, particularly in relation to children. So there is just this general idea that whereas for a grown-up, maybe to get your right of erasure, you have to show the data's unnecessary or too old or unlawful, whatever it is, some kind of reason, really. For children's data, that's not the case. The idea that, just as all of us are probably quite pleased the internet wasn't around when we were teenagers, for the same reason, the idea here is that for children, they get to make their mistakes, and then they get to rub them out, because that is a good thing. And then, right, finally, these are examples. We did a, we got so into this that we created an app, and it did all sorts of crazy things. And then we wanted to show how you could make it compliant with some of these rules. Now, I'll be honest with you, this stuff, we wrote it and developed them before the GDPR, but it illustrates, because it was sort of best practice, it meets the requirements of GDPR. So what we're starting to see, what we're telling clients is, on the App Store, so that's a fictitious app, there isn't really a Bristow's Smart Tea app, but on the App Store, don't just say what the app does, have something about privacy. Even if it's just a link to your privacy policy, get it in early. In the app, then we're seeing, and we do see this on some apps, layers. This is a summary. People might read that, maybe. They won't read the one in the middle, which is the one you click on to get the whole policy. And then most compliance with apps, both now and under GDPR, is achieved through settings. It's a functionality thing. It's not something you can fix with words. It's something you fix with how the app is designed. That's why privacy by design is so important. And so these kind of settings for location, data sharing, social interactions, a purge function, that kind of thing. We're starting to see a lot more of that, and that's written into the GDPR. The ability to give consent and take it away just as easily will turn into more granular settings, I think. Okay, I have remembered. The GDPR, let's have a show of hands. Is it good for technology? Hands up. John, you've got to put your hand up. You come on. Yeah, I'm not having a go. I'm just curious. All right, and not so good for technology? Anyone? Okay, there's quite a bit of fence sitting going on, isn't there? All right, anyway, well, thank you. Thank you. That's everything. Thanks very much.
I got to say, I'm going to be really disappointed, or unhappy, I should say, if my Weight Watchers app talks to my Fitbit, and then my charge card sees where I go out to eat, and my Amazon Fresh account, because the only thing my Weight Watchers app is going to order me is basically Brussels sprouts and tofu. So at the moment, I'm really down on the Internet of Things. I'm the token American on the panel, and I'm probably here because actually I've practiced law in both Europe and America on privacy. And so I think that's why they allow me to join. And I want to say it's really difficult to be an American practicing privacy law in Europe, because you immediately, as soon as they hear your accent over there, they don't really trust anything, you were informed earlier. In the U.S., the Brits come over and, you know, you hear their accent, and basically their IQ is perceived as being about 10, 20%, you know, higher, 10, 20 points higher. And then they're always considered, you know, truthful because of the accent. But I want to point out Mark here as being really unfair because he's brought reading glasses as well. And that's a whole nother 10 points. And I pose the question, can you really trust somebody who's working so hard to get you to trust them? Because he was really working those on, off, on, off. All right. So I know I stand between you and the alcohol. And I just also want to say that I said they should serve alcohol during the presentation. But there was something about what you would retain and antics of the law students. First of all, interrupt with questions. I get bored if I just keep talking and talking. So you should feel free to interrupt. Boom. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how do you deal with all this. And I only have 4 slides. You've heard a lot about the law, the requirements. And when John and I often go out and speak to clients, and John kind of lays on the spiel about all the requirements, and, you know, we talk with the clients about how this could really impact their operations, they start to get a little panicky. And, you know, it's going back to basics, that this is really developing a regulatory change program. It's project management at its most fundamentals. It may be project management on steroids, but at the end of the day, it's basically breaking down the requirements, understanding how they impact your business, and building a list of activities, dates that need to be completed by, resources, et cetera. it's not rocket science. So I suppose in some ways I'm here to just remind you that it's not rocket science, and don't panic, as Mark had said earlier. Before I start a little bit on the slides, I was reflecting on what everybody was saying earlier. And, you know, one organization I practice law in as in-house counsel, there was a very clear line between legal and operations. The lawyers did the legal piece. You know, they might get involved a little bit on the policy drafting, but ops was specific to ops. They did the operational pieces. They wrote the procedures. Very clear lines. And another organization I was in-house counsel at, very different. Lawyers were supposed to be up to their elbows in operations, looking at the procedures, meeting with the business, understanding the technology, really getting into the meat of everyday operations. And also the business, the ops people were supposed to have a basic understanding of the regulatory implications. Two very different cultures. Fine, you know, one not better than the other. As I reflect on all of the impact that I think the GDPR will have for many of you, particularly where data is your lifeblood, I think that it's going to be very important for lawyers to be much more involved in the day-to-day operations, understanding them more, understanding the technology. You're going to have to dive, for many of you, deeper than you have before. And for some, that may be leaving your comfort zones. I think generally you will find the business very receptive to your involvement most of the time. It's going to be a lot about working very closely with them, or else you will not be able to properly advise your clients. So roll up the elbows and dig in on the operational side. The other piece I'll say is that, you know, one of the parts of my business, my practice is helping with regulatory relations, and that'll be the other piece. It's not going to be just understanding the law. It's going to be going out, building relationships proactively where you can with regulators, and regulators are different all around the globe about what they'll talk to you about, what they won't, under which circumstances. So, you know, lots of caveats there. But it's going to make sure that you understand what are the policy drivers behind the language in the regulation, and then some of the regulation that will be, or rules that are promulgated underneath the GDPR, so that way you can advise your clients properly. So helping them navigate regulatory relationships is going to be very important. Trying to reduce the friction between your businesses and the regulators will be absolutely critical, in my opinion. So those are two things, sort of two themes, I think, I hope to instill in you and that you will take away. So, without further ado, so what do you need to do tomorrow? What do you do when you leave here? You've learned a lot today from John and Mark about what the requirements are. You've learned a lot about what some of the issues are. You need to just now begin to take that further. You need to deepen your understanding of the GDPR. And again, not rocket science here. You know, for me, I start with the articles. Why is it organized the way it is? What are some of the policies sitting behind the language in the GDPR? Okay. And then moving on to understanding what the implications may be for your industry and focusing on some of the lawyers and consulting firms that put out articles that are specific to your industry and understanding what some of the hot button issue points will be. And start putting together that punch list of issues. And then I would do a pretty, thorough, but a quick read through the GDPR with a couple of different highlighter colors, pulling out the issues. What are the points that you want clarification on? Oh, this will be an issue for me. I'm not sure about this. I need more information. And then doing another thorough reading and really getting in depth and understanding what all the concepts mean and their implications for your business. Now, you're not going to get it all at once. This is a long, complicated regulation. I think that, not rocket science, but for any new regulation, trying to find some of the, how it's going to impact what all the touch points are for your business is going to require you to liaise with your business. It's going to take looking at, you know, it's 2 years here before it becomes into effect. That's a lifetime in many of your businesses. Your strategies will move on. New products will be introduced. There'll be new litigation. Privacy Shield, no doubt, will be litigated. This is something that's going to have to do on a continuous rolling basis. But the general theme is educate, spot the issues, and begin to work those issues through with your stakeholders in the business. It's also time to, if it's not, you haven't done so already, begin to raise the alarm on the GDPR is coming here, folks. These are some of the issues that we as a business will begin to struggle with. You need to be starting to move, starting to have conversations with, you know, senior management in your C-suite. This will, for most of you, require additional resources. Your teams will expand. You will need money for change management programs, okay? Anybody that's sort of done this or, you know, large change management programs will know you just don't throw the deck in front of your senior management or the C-suite. They should never see any of these concepts for the first time in a deck. This is, means about you have to start to iron out your positions, start to have thinking about what the resources might be, what the impacts might be on your business, okay? And you need to start having those coffees with your key stakeholders, informing this, informing them, soliciting their opinions. You must listen as much as you talk, if not more. So you need to be starting to push the information here up. Let them know this is coming, that this is something that's going to have to be dealt with, and it's serious. And a great tagline is, you know, 20 million or 4% of revenues, whatever is greater. Okay? That's going to get people's attention. And there's a lot of good information out there floating around, as though, you're going to have to weed your way through some of it. You know, there's a lot out there at this point, so you should be able to educate yourself. So that's tomorrow. So what do you do, say, by June, another quarter from now? And the dates, you know, this is somewhat arbitrary, right? For some of you, it's May. Some of you, it's August, right? Some of you have enormous businesses that are operating in many different jurisdictions. Some of you have many different products and services. Some of you are much more focused in a particular product area. Some of you, you know, what GE versus, you know, a small startup has to worry about, very different. So sort of the dates, the timeline is going to be different for you. But 2 years will pass. I have four-year-old twins. 2 years is half their lifetime. They have gone to talking, being this, you know, and to talking and stringing together sentences and going to the bathroom on their own. 2 years is fast. I could work in some more bathroom analogies, but John told me not to do that. They didn't play well. Anyways, so you need to put together a change management program, okay? As I said before, activities. What are the actions that are going to we need to put in place so that we can achieve our goals, so that we can understand what these impact is going to be in our business? What are the activities we have to do? Activities or actions are useless unless they have dates certain and resources against them, okay? If you don't have the resources, your plan is useless. Mike picked that up. So resourcing requirements. What are the skills that you're going to need, okay? How's this going to affect, you know, a technology-heavy company or versus somebody that just makes widgets? What are the resources that you're going to need in order to drive change, from project management to people that are going to have to build applications for you, write code, et cetera, the skills. Project governance, very important. How are decisions going to be made when one part of the business says, you know what, we're not going to put up X amount of money that you say we need? How is that issue going to be resolved? What are the communication paths up to senior management and the C-suite if necessary to get that resolved? Project governance is very important. BAU, business as usual versus change. So what it takes to drive a change program through your organization is one thing. Another thing is what is daily life going to be after the program has finished? You need to define that, okay? And generally, I'm going to say generally, but in many cases, the change program actually costs more. You're driving that change. You're building new functions. You're adding, increasing your staff, paying contractors, which generally may be higher in cost, bringing in lawyers, consultants, et cetera, versus the full-time staff that are going to be running your program after your project has gone all the way through. So it's very important to define what business as usual will look like. And you don't need to do that right away. I think that's, like, for many organizations can be, it takes time because you're not sure what the operating model will be. What are the, how many people you need spread out through your organization to be able to ensure compliance with the GDPR. And then, of course, as I mentioned before, your organizations are expanding and growing and adding new products and services. So, you know, this can evolve and move. You need to make sure you have sort of your pulse on the business, because this may affect, you know, what you thought it was going to cost here 6 months later when you're about to roll out a massive new product or service. Suddenly, maybe BAU looks very different. So it's something you need to be constantly revisiting. As someone who spends a lot of time helping clients navigate problematic relationships with regulators, one of the things, a little practice point, is what I call artifacts. So when you got your project plan there that's got your activities and your dates and your resources, for each activity, what is going to artifact that's going to be created? How do you document that indeed you've looked at the risks here, that they were escalated to the appropriate individuals to either accept, sign off on, or that it was tasked to a particular business that they have to put up some resources? Many cases, it's obvious policies, procedures, et cetera. But this is something that comes in handy. Regulators love, you know, that documentation. They love something tangible they can stick their hands on, that, you know, you said you did X, and now you actually have something that shows you did it. Evidence of compliance is very important. And later on, when the auditors, your internal audit team comes through, you know, whether it's a project audit or after BAU's in place, now you've got all this evidence to be able to hand over them. Yes, we did X, and here you go. Here's the evidence of that. Particularly challenging, I think, and important for this audience, which is very technology-driven, those organizations that create process through the tools that they use. So, you know, an easy one is, you know, when I was at Barclays, for example, we created a product launch portal. And, you know, it had tax, you had to go through legal, you had to go sign off. Information had to be pushed into there about what the product was. And everybody, you know, each of the departments had to sign off. We'd push in remedial action if necessary as a SME. You'd have a sign off, yes, it can launch, but you need to do X, Y, and Z in 6 months. So you can then take, in those cases, you know, the procedure there doesn't need to necessarily be a piece of paper. Or if it is, it's a piece of paper light. How do you evidence in those situations that the procedure has been pushed through? Well, it's log files, but are the regulators going to understand what the log files are? How do you make that digestible to organizations that come in from the outside, whether it's your lawyers who advise you, regulators that come in because they have a right to audit or because it's an investigation? FTC comes in. How do you show that you have had reasonable privacy and security? So for those of you who do a lot of automation, to have a think about the evidence. How much is this all going to cost me? Very important. You don't, so often I see clients, you know, they do a lot of work, they put the deck together, and then so there's the CPO sitting with the deck, and he's got to present, he or she has to present tomorrow, you know, to senior management, and they're like winging it about what they think this is going to cost. Don't wing it, you know. You're just shooting yourself in the foot. And, you know, chances are your senior management and C-suite's relatively intelligent, and they're going to start to pick out the weaknesses about the costs. And that's just not a position you want to be in. You want to be able to identify, you know, what are the various projects that are in play or that I need to develop, get off the ground in order to drive compliance with the GDPR by June 2018. If you've got large IT transformation projects underway, some three-year HR, you know, program, you're doing, you know, Oracle Fusion, and you're a massive multinational. Now suddenly the GDPR gets dropped right in the middle of all this, and safe harbor's out the door, and we got to worry about litigation with Privacy Shield. How are you going to deal with all this? So you need to be able to identify all those projects that are in flight and start to understand the impacts and start adjusting trajectory as necessary. Questions to consider immediately, and I think this plays on a lot of what John and Mark said. You know, think about the one-stop shop. You know, what's your main establishment? Where are you headquartered? Where do you have the most employees? In Europe, or if you don't have any employees, you're not headquartered really anywhere, you just got a lot of employees working remotely throughout Europe. Well, you know, start trying to figure out your way through that mess. Data protection officer and chief privacy officer. Does it make sense to have your CPO being your DPO at the same time? Can you do that? One of the great things is it's hard to fire your DPO. They're supposed to be sort of independent, advising the business on compliance. It can be get very sticky if you want to get that person out. So some of you may want to be the DPO and get employment for life. Brexit scenario planning. I was having a beer with John last night, and I asked John, I said, so outline the scenarios here if, you know, Britain leaves the EU. And boy, that was complicated. You know, I was kind of thinking, you know, well, if they leave, it's going to look like this, and if they stay, it's going to look like this. No, it's basically if they leave, there's this option, this could happen, this could happen, this could happen. Very complicated. That is a question for John over a beer. I recommend you have two before you ask. Identifying the hotspots for your business model. Again, you know, not rocket science here, but, you know, what are the core risks to how you generate revenue? You know, if you work with, if your model, if you're Disney and you, you know, part of your model is, you know, key to your model is collecting data from children, how do you deal with a, or, you know, different ages of consent to collect consent in the different jurisdictions? And what happens if, you know, the child resides in England and then, you know, you collect consent there and then you move, the child moves to France or is there for just the summer or at camp? What are the risks that are posed to you? Do you need to worry about the canal coming in? Or are they going to have other priorities? There's some places here you may want to accept some risk. There are places that you may not. A lot depends on your regulatory posture. If you've had a history of confrontation with the canal, maybe you'll be a little bit more conservative. If the canal loves you or you're not on their radar screen, then maybe you'll accept some risk. So thinking through the issues there. It is 5:55, 5 minutes between you and alcohol. You tell, I just, I was a trial lawyer for 5 years. I would just go on a rant. Judge would have to be like, Michael, counselor, settle down. So this is what I just talked about. Jim, you got to tell me, you know, earlier on. All right, so this is the slide I'm currently on, at least on my little iPad Pro here. All right, so by December 31st, 2016, so the end of the year, where should you be? Your change program should be well underway. If you're just getting it up and running, you know, that's probably not great. The strategic decisions that we talked about here, over on the right, hotspots, for example, how are you going to deal with that? Identifying those two bubbles, those decisions probably should be made. Now, I did say you got to keep an eye on these on an ongoing basis. Your awareness for the business should definitely be well underway. Current state analysis, data mapping complete. So, you know, think about there, as I mentioned, that there'll be some new rules that the member states get to promulgate. So, for example, consent with regards to children. You want to be keeping your, you're keeping your eye on these. And as these things change, constantly revising, reviewing your plan, do I need to be making any changes, et cetera. Lobbying. So, for some of the larger organizations, where, again, the member states can promulgate some rules under the regulation, you want to start to think, you know, do I want to be doing any lobbying here? Is it worth it? Looking out after number one is some opportunity for you here. You know, do I want to build my empire? Do I want to take on more responsibility? Do I want to suck in records management? Or is that like, you know, the Antichrist and I don't want anything to do with records management? Which would be my personal opinion, but hey. So there's some opportunities here. Think about how this could affect your career. Do you want to be a DPO or do you want to focus on being the CPO? Personal exposure managed. Not all organizations are going to do a good job of managing their risk and compliance with regards to the GDPR. You don't want to be left holding the bag. How do you ensure that that's not the case? Every once in a while, I'll see a job description and somebody will approach me and say, Michael, come work for us. And you can see that the job's basically constructed so that when something goes wrong, I'm the person they get to fire. You don't want to be holding the bag in that set of circumstances. What's success look like? A lot of times this is left out. What, at the end of the day, does it look like? What does compliance look like? Going back to my earlier point, how do I evidence it? Because someday, senior management will hold you accountable for the money that you've spent. Audit will come in. and say, what have you done? Does this work? And you want to be able to say, yes, here is what success looks like. I know this because we agreed it during our project planning. We ran it through our project governance. And, you know, the senior VP signed off on this is what success looks like. And if you don't think so, you can go argue with our CEO. So that's very good. Now, June 18. Well, basically, you have to be in compliance. And if you're not, you're scrambling pretty quickly here. But you want to be able to evidence compliance. Really critical thing, okay? To your internal stakeholders, senior management and C-suite. Internal audit, because someday they're going to be coming rolling through. Jim, you did not tell me to do slides again. And regulators. You want to make sure that you can evidence compliance to regulators, because you don't want to be that person who, how was it put earlier, the race to the top for fines. Not the list you want to be on. There'll be times, as I mentioned before, where you're going to want to accept some risks. You want to make sure that there is a process for that being in place. Many of your organizations should already have a risk acceptance policy there, risk register, what are the mitigating controls, so on and so forth. You want to make sure all of that is very clearly documented and probably involving all of you as legal counsel, because there'll be some points where you're going to want to exercise or be hopefully be able to exercise privilege and making sure certain documents don't see the light of day. I don't mean that in a hiding sense, but you know, there's going to be a lot of legal advice here that needs to be provided. And so making sure that you take the proper steps to protect your client from a privilege perspective is going to be very important. You don't want to be arguing when the regulators come in over this. When you're doing your project governance, what are the points that legal is going to need to be involved? How do we maintain privilege? Because you know some idiot's going to CC somebody and then privilege goes right out the door. So making sure that everybody that's involved in this project is educated on it. There's going to be a lot of non-legal people involved, and you want to make sure that they don't screw you. This is being recorded, huh? Processes and controls embedded, policies and procedures fully signed off and operationalized, governance documentation being produced and stored, and then most importantly, the party at the end. And it's 6:01, and so on that theme, I shall conclude. All right. Thank you.